Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from Pastor Luke Cobray.
Father, we come before you, Lord, and we're just so grateful for the opportunity that we have to be here. Lord, we lift up the name of Jesus in this house. We don't come to hear from a man, to hear from a woman, from the older, from the young. Lord, we acknowledge that it's Jesus Christ that's the senior leader of this church. And Lord, in the name of Jesus, we ask that your Holy Spirit would be our teacher, be our counselor, and lead us and guide us and direct us and motivate us to do what you've called us to do and to teach us and equip us out of your word how to be what you've called us to be. And Lord, we thank you for your marvelous and wonderful grace that enables us and empowers us to become what you have called us to be. Lord, we thank you that we don't do this alone, but Lord, we do this by your might and by your power. Father, we thank you for all that you've blessed us with here at this church. And Lord, we don't ever think of ourselves as better than anybody else, but rather we're co-laborers, members of the same body, working together to build your kingdom. So Father, with that, we ask that you would bless all the churches across the Inland Empire and around the world that are preaching and hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ. Father, we thank you for our Catholic brothers and sisters and our Adventist brothers and sisters, all the denominational brothers and sisters, Calvary Chapels, Harvest and the Grove and Sandals. Lord, we thank you for Water of Life, Ecclesia, Emmanuel Baptist, Trinity, and New Creation. Lord, we thank you that you would bless them as you've blessed us. Lord, we thank you that we're brothers and sisters in the body of Christ, working together to build your kingdom for your glory. So, Father, to you be the praise, the glory, and the honor. In Jesus' mighty name, we all said,
amen.
Amen. Well, praise God. If you've got your Bible, your tablet, your phone, your nail, whatever it might be, go ahead and turn with me. I'm going to take you to two places today. Go with me to Genesis in the 13th chapter, as well as 1 Peter, 2nd chapter. So if you got that little ribbon, go to 1 Peter, drop it in there, and go with me to Genesis in the 13th chapter. We're going to talk a little bit about the subject of living on the edge or on the edge of compromise. Compromise is one of those subjects within Christianity that sometimes we don't talk about it, we don't address it, and it's one of those words that when you look at the term compromise, it really has a duality to it. There's a good compromise and there's a bad compromise. And when I say a good compromise, when we want to hold true to our standards, you know, we can say that there's no such thing as a good compromise, but all I have to say is get married and you'll realize that there is a good compromise. You know what I'm talking about? I like sandwiches, she likes Mexican food, the compromise is whatever she likes. Amen. But when it comes to our spiritual walks, when it comes to what God has called us to do, when it comes to our lives, you know, the truth of the matter is that we have one life to live here on earth. We only get one run at it. There's no do-overs, there's no reset button, there's no second chances at making things right. We get each day, every day is a gift. That's why they call it the present, right? You've heard that. I don't know, I think it's like in The Lion King or something like that. Either way, it's so important for us to make decisions in our lives, to live our lives out in a way that's pleasing and honorable to God, that he might bless us, that he might direct us, that he might lead us. And oftentimes what happens is we get wrapped up in this little thing that we call compromise. And I'm not talking about the compromise of two parties coming together, making concessions on each side so that they can come to a mutual agreement. We live in that world. We come in that world. But there's another type of compromise. A compromise is to lower one's standards to less than acceptable. You know, you can say it like this. You know, I've heard it said, you know, companies say, I'm not willing to compromise on your safety. Which means I'm not willing to lower our standards for the sake of your safety. And that's the type of compromise that's so important for you and I to have an understanding about and to see what the Bible talks about that. And as I was reading through, and we had gone through the stories in our young adult service, and I had the opportunity to teach a message on Abraham's nephew, Lot. We're not going to talk about that. But in looking at the story of Lot, there were some very important things, some very interesting things that happened in Lot's life. And I believe it really tells the story for you and I of compromise. And then I want to come back to towards the latter part of the Bible in the book of 1 Peter. And I want to look at what the Bible says about how we can address or how we can apply what we understand. So I had you turn with me to the book of Genesis. And we want to look at the story of Abraham's nephew, Lot. Now, when it comes to compromise, hey, listen, it happens to the best of us. Can I just say that? There's no amen on that one. Everybody's like, nah. It happens to all of us. You're not too far gone to fall to compromise. Can I just tell you like it is? You're not too righteous. You're not too holy. You're not too into God to slip up and to make a mistake, because we'll see in the story of Lot, there's some things that happen with Lot's life that brought him to the position that we read. And as we see in the narrative, there's some very important things, subtle but important things for us to take. And I'll just tell you the truth, man, I have made mistakes. I'm not supposed to tell you that. But I have slipped in my life and given into compromises. To have to live with the results and the consequences of compromising my standards, my walk with God, and to have to deal with the consequences that follow. Nobody's perfect. Nobody's too far gone or too far into it that they can't trip and stumble on their own lives. But you know what? God is so good. We have this thing called grace, and we'll talk about that. Praise God. That enables us to go beyond where we're at to a place where God has called us. But important for us is to understand what compromise can do to our lives and to understand the narrative and to understand the subtleties of compromise and looking at that. And so we're talking about the edge of compromise or being on the edge of compromise. And I had you go with me to the book of Genesis in the 13th chapter. Genesis chapter 13, I got to take my little ribbon and go there as well. We're looking at the story of a man named Lot. Now let me give you a little bit of narrative here. Lot is a man, Abraham's nephew. Now, the previous chapter, Genesis, in the 12th chapter is when we see Abraham or Abram. And the Bible tells us that God calls Abram and says, go to a land that I will show you and you will be blessed. All the nations of the world will call you blessed. So Abram basically follows God's directive, God's leading. And Abraham picks up, takes his stuff, brings his family. Lot is a member of his family in that sense. So he takes and they go on a journey through the promised land to a place that God begins to show them. And God speaks to Abraham and through the course of the journey, God blesses Abraham and everybody who's around. And so here we pick up in Genesis in the 13th chapter. The Bible begins to describe Abraham's nephew Lot and Abraham. And what happens is that God has so blessed them in their lives because of Abraham's faithfulness to God that Lot and Abraham are so blessed that literally the ground can no longer contain the two of them together. This was a time when they didn't have technology, they didn't have cars and airplanes and the internet, and business wasn't done online through digital transactions. When you had possessions, you had a lot of them. You had sheep, you had cattle, you had horses, you had camel, you had fields, you had agriculture. And so here the Bible begins to tell and describe to you and I in the narrative of the book of Genesis of Abraham's life, and in looking at Abraham's life, we see a glimpse into his nephew Lot's life. That they became so blessed that their workers, there was so much going on that Lot's servants and Abraham's servants were kind of bumping into each other. Hey, this is where my sheep are grazing. No, your sheep are supposed to be over there on that hill. And hey, no, you're supposed to be doing this over here. This isn't your spot. This is our spot. There was no more personal space. So Abraham comes to Lot and he says, listen, man, we got to deal with this cordially. We got to do something. You and I are so blessed. It's a good problem to have. Amen. He said, we are so blessed that the land cannot contain us. So Abraham says to Lot, here's what I'm going to do. I want you to have first pick. Wherever you look, wherever you see, you choose the land you want to occupy. And if you go east, I'll go west. If you go north, I'll go south. We'll separate, we'll split ways, not because we're on bad terms, but literally, we need room to grow. And so the Bible begins to describe to us and tells us in this narrative of Abraham and his nephew Lot some very subtle things that we see in this depiction or in this story. And so we'll pick up in Genesis in the 13th chapter. And I'm going to read verse number 9. I don't think verse number 9 is on the overhead, but we'll pick up in verse number 10 where we want to focus in on this narrative. He says, is not the whole land before you? Please separate from me. This is Abraham speaking to his nephew. If you take the left, then I'll go right. Or if you go to the right, then I'll go left. Now, verse number 10, it says, and Lot lifted up his eyes and saw all the plains of Jordan, that it was well watered everywhere. And in parentheses, it tells us, because this is looking back in hindsight, before the Lord destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah, like the garden of the Lord, like the land of Egypt, as you go towards Zoar. Then Lot chose for himself all of the plain of Jordan, and Lot journeyed east, and they separated from each other. Abraham dwelt in the land of Canaan, and Lot dwelt in the cities of the plain, and pitched his tent even as far as Sodom. And just in these couple of verses, you know, you might look at that and say, okay, cool. I mean, there's nothing I see that's wrong with this. And truth be told, there's nothing that's wrong with what's being said here. But there's some subtleties that are written in this narrative that when we look at this, we can look over them. We don't understand. But through a deeper study, through a deeper understanding of God's word, we can see what the narrative is actually trying to depict to you and I some thousands of years later after its writing. And so today, I want to look at understanding this, some principles or some understandings of this subject of compromise, of lowering our standards to less than desirable results so that we might do something. And looking at some of these things here, and you know, they say one of the first steps of dealing or overcoming an issue is identifying or realizing that you have one. You know what I'm talking about? Right? They say like the first stages of denial is denial, right? I don't have any problems, right? So the first steps of realizing or overcoming issues, compromise being a great issue in Christianity, especially in our day and age, church, can we be real? I mean, there's a lot of Christians out there right now that are living compromised lives in the name of Christianity and grace and don't recognize or realize the issues that they're living with and that they're creating for those around you. So the first steps in understanding the edge of compromise or living this and how to get beyond this and how that we don't fall into this trap of compromise is to understand the issues of compromise and understand how it works for you and I. And I believe here in Genesis in the 13th chapter, in these few verses, really gives us a great insight of how compromise works in our lives. So I just want to go back and just look at these, some of these statements here that begins to speak to you and I. Looking at verse number 10, it says, "And Lot lifted up his eyes." And Lot lifted his eyes. That statement, lifted his eyes, and actually that statement, lifted his eyes and saw, is actually an allegory, or it's in relation to things that had happened in previous events in the Genesis account. All the way back to the very creation when the Bible tells us that Eve saw with her eyes that the fruit was good. The Bible tells us in Genesis, the 6th chapter, that the sons of God saw the women of the earth and saw that they were good. So here, there's something about this statement. Not just the fact that you and I might read this and say, well, Lot looked around. Abraham said, hey, pick a land. And Lot just went like this. Oh, that one. That there's actually something deeper here being said, that Lot with his eyes lifted up his eyes. And here the thing about compromise comes like this. Compromise is birthed in selfishness. Compromise is birthed in selfishness. You see, when you look at compromise as the duality of compromise, two parties coming together, making mutual concessions to arrive at an agreement, you look at that and you say, well, how is there anything selfish in that? Can I ask the other end of the question? If you have to make concessions, the selfishness is, why are you holding on to your opinion? If it was all about selflessness, wouldn't you just say, you know what, not my opinion, yours. If it's so important to you, instead of compromising, we'll just go with what you have to say. And so here the Bible tells us that in Lot's life, that in Lot's story, in the subtle statement, Lot lifted up his eyes and saw, we see that compromise begins, it's birthed in selfishness. Lot's desire. Lot wanted to pick the greatest land, the most desirable place. Lot was looking for what was best for him, not thinking or including or going about what was best for Abraham. So Lot lifted up his eyes and he began to see. Compromise is birth in selfishness. Take it a step further. Our spiritual walks, when it comes to compromise, why is it that we compromise? Why is it that we fall into compromise in our spiritual walks? It's because we want to do something contrary to what the Word of God says. Anybody give me an amen? Amen. Well, Pastor Luke, I don't fall into the sexual immorality trap, or I don't deal with this, or I don't deal. The Bible talks about don't being a glutton. Can we be real together? I mean, we're talking about Americans, right? Don't be a glutton. There's a problem. You know why? Because on Monday I had a lazy day and I ate a whole bag of Lay's in one sitting. A whole bag. That's a problem. You know what I'm talking to? Anybody? You're laughing because you're like, man, all right, praise God, I'm not alone. It may not be Lay's salt and vinegar for me. Some of you are like, oh no. Maybe it's an ice cream. Maybe you've been there before. You got nothing to do, right? Open up the freezer. That Rocky Road ice cream looking good. Amen. You say, I'm gonna start with a little bowl, right? A scoop. I'm on a diet. It's my cheat day. All of a sudden, self kicks in. Oh, that's good. I like that. You look over on the counter, you see an apple. I should eat that. But yourself says, no, I don't want that. I want the ice cream. So what do? Get another spoon. Or you do it like me. I just get a bigger spoon, right? Go from that little tiny one to the big one. And get a little bit more. Oh, man, that's good. Look down. Well, there's not really enough for anybody else, and I don't want to be selfish. I have to do somebody a favor, the next person, and just finish it off because they're going to be mad at. You know what I'm talking about. See, compromise is birthed in self, in selfishness. It's all about us, our desires, our will, our ways, our wants. What's best for me? And when we realize that compromise is birthed in selfishness, then we can begin to realize how we can address it in our lives. But if we're unaware that we're being selfish, hello, then we don't know what to do. So compromise is birthed in selfishness. Looking again now, it says, Genesis in the 13th chapter, it goes on and he says, he looked up and saw all the plain of the Jordan. Look at what he says here. It says that it was well watered everywhere before the Lord destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah, like the gardens of the Lord. You see, this term right here, the gardens of the Lord, Lot knew. Lot's going on. He's talking about this. Moses, as he's writing this back, he's giving us another allegory. He's giving us another relation. Lot is literally comparing or thinking now that this is like the Garden of Eden. Man, this is the best place that can ever be. There's no place better right here. I'm picking the very best spot. But I love how we look back on hindsight. Don't you know how to say that? Hindsight's 20/20. We see with clear vision. The Bible even gives us the end of the story at the very beginning. He says it was like a well-watered garden, in parentheses, before the Lord destroyed. Compromise is all about the here and the now. Compromise is all about the here and the now. It only sees the here and the now things. Compromise only sees the here and the now. The short-term reward doesn't recognize or realize or care about the long-term consequences. Maybe you've done something. I'll tell you what, there's been times in my life, and listen, like I said, I'm not perfect. Oh boy, hallelujah, praise God, I'm not perfect. There are times in my life where I say things that I should not say. Anybody know what I'm talking about? I've been working really hard lately at not talking as much. I've found this amazing principle in life that if you're talking, you're not listening, right? So I try not to say as much as I, why? Because when I say, what happens is I just let my mouth kind of go. It just kind of works that way. It just kind of keeps running. And then all of a sudden I put my foot in my mouth, offend somebody, hurt somebody's feelings, say something, or heaven forbid when I'm upset or angry and I've stubbed my toe, that one word. You know what I'm talking about? Those high school words? I won't say that one specific word because you might have a different specific word. I don't want to go on that level, all right? But there's that one word. It's the here and the now. I just got to do it now. I don't care about what happens. How about this? Guys. Guys deal with the purity issue. Girls, you deal with it too. You're not exempt. We'll get to the 50 Shades of Grey thing in a minute. The here and the now. I don't care about what happens. I don't care about the consequences. I don't care about the long-term effects. I want it now. You see, compromise only sees the here and the now. It doesn't look forward. It doesn't see what's beyond the bend. It only wants to see what's going on right now. But you see, it's so important for us to see the long-term effects of what happens. Because like I said, we got one life to live. There's no reset button. There's no do-over. We've got one chance at what we do. And that's all we have. And if we neglect or fail to see the here and the now or the long-term consequences and live only in the here and the now, live for the moment, we say. We miss out on what God has for us because everything we do has consequences. Compromise only sees the here and the now. Here he's equating it to the Garden of Eden. But it, ironically, as the narrative, as the text tells us, Lot chooses it because of its lush watering and its garden-like capabilities or qualities. Yet here we see the later, the long term, becomes fire and brimstone ruins. Becomes a wasteland, a salted sea, a desert area, no longer habitable and sustainable. Yet Lot saw the here and the now. Compromise takes us to the here and now. Going on, this is where it really gets important for you and I. Are y'all right tonight? Yes. I know, it's probably not an amen message. You're like, man, I wanted to hoot and holler some. Elijah got us all pumped up for praise and worship, and Pastor Luke brings it all down. It goes on and it says, then Lot chose for himself the plain of all the Jordan's journeyed east. And they separated from each other. Verse number 12, Abraham dwelt in the land of Canaan. Lot dwelt in the cities of the plain. Look at what it says here. And pitched his tent as far as Sodom. Pitched his tent as far as Sodom. So important for you. Compromise. Start small. Compromise starts small, but it brings great ruin. When we look at the word Sodom in the Bible, we know what Sodom is synonymous with. Do we know what Sodom is synonymous with? Sin. Sodom is the city of sin. In all representation, Sodom is a depravity against God and humanity's sins against the Lord. And the Bible tells us that Lot pitched his tents as far as Sodom, which means Lot literally went and camped on the edge of compromise, a place that had a reputation, a place that was known around for what it was doing, that there was a great cry. Why do we know that Sodom had a reputation? Because God says to Abraham, I have heard the cries against Sodom. People were crying out against this city for what they were doing. And yet Lot camped on the edge of compromise. In our day and age, what happens is compromise, it starts small. So many people come, especially as pastors, we get this, as they ask the technical questions. Okay, pastor, can I do this? Because the Bible doesn't say no. But pastor, God made drugs. I only do the natural stuff. The Bible doesn't say I can't eat it. Pastor, we're getting married anyways. We've been living together for so long that the government counts us as married already. So what we do is we ask each other, ask God, God, how far or how close to the edge can I step without falling over? Because that's where I want to live. And you see, compromise always starts small, but it brings great ruin. When we want to camp on the edge like Lot, as far as Sodom, it starts small. It seems insignificant. But did you know? It'll always grow. It's like a snowball going down a hill on a snowy day. It starts out small, a little pebble rolling down the hill, but then it picks up momentum and it picks up mass and it picks up speed and it picks up size and it picks up weight. And then all of a sudden, by the time it gets to the bottom of the hill, it's this immovable, unstoppable force that creates great havoc on whatever it hits. Compromise starts small. Lot was looking what was best for him. Do you know that the Bible tells us over the course of Abraham's life, it includes the story of Lot in certain areas. Lot camps as far as Sodom. Guess what happens to Lot? He gets taken captive. Loses everything. Abraham, his uncle, goes and rescues him. Takes everything back. So, you know, you think Lot would say, okay, thanks, uncle. I'm not going to that place again. Man, those guys over there, they're mean. They're crying out again. I've heard the cries against them. You know what the Bible tells us in the book of Genesis, and I think it's the 19th chapter, when the angels of the Lord go to investigate Sodom? They tell Abraham, Abraham, we're going to go look at Sodom. We're going to go see if what's being said is really true. You know what the Bible tells us? They find Lot. Not on the outskirts. Not on the road too. They find Lot sitting at the gate of Sodom. Now, he's gone from camping on the outside of Sodom to becoming a resident of the city. The angels, they're going to go camp in the courtyard of the city. Lot says, no, man, this is, you think San Bernardino's bad? Lot says, stay with me. The whole town surrounds them. Lot was engulfed in Sodom. And we'll see in just a moment that he was so engulfed because we know what happens to his wife in hindsight. The Bible tells us the angels grab them at the very last minute, take them out of the city and say, don't you look back when you hear what's going on. Yet Lot's wife was so connected to that city, she couldn't help but to look back to see what her life was, what was happening to that which was important to her life. And the Bible tells us she turned into a pillar of salt. The end result of Lot's story, Lot lost everything he had. Here's a man that the Bible tells us was so blessed that the land could not contain him and his uncle. They had to separate. Here's a man that was so blessed, he had too many servants, too many sheep, too many possessions. And at the end of Lot's story, as we read it, Lot ends up with nothing. The angels grab him, his wife, and his two daughters and rip them out of the city as it's about to be destroyed. Lot literally has nothing. And on the way out, Lot's wife looks back and is killed. All Lot has is himself and his two daughters. And the Bible tells us the last we hear of Lot is that him and his daughters are hiding in a cave for fear that they're the only humans left on the earth. And his two daughters trick him, get him drunk to sleep with him so that they think that they might procreate the world. Consequence starts small. Well, it's just a peek. It's just a sip. Well, it's just one little juicy comment. It starts small. But when you open the door to compromise, it's a hard door to close. And that's why it's so important to understand how compromise works in our life. It's birthed in selfishness. It only sees the here and the now. It doesn't look to the long-term effects. And it starts out small. It's subtle, little. But I'll tell you what, there's some things that we can do to apply in our lives, some of the Word of God that we can apply in our lives so that we don't fall into this trap, so that we don't end up like Lot. Remember I said, you're not too far gone into God that you can't slip up into compromise. Listen, there are pastors of mega churches around the world that have crumbled because of bad decisions. One small decision that nobody saw led to another, to another, to another, until the whole house of cards came down. Lot was a man blessed by God, yet his life crumbled apart. But we don't have to live that life. Amen? Amen. We don't have to be that way. We don't have to succumb to the consequences because God has given us some great things in our life to apply. And today I want to take you there. I had you turn to the book of 1 Peter. Now let's look at how we can apply the Word of God to our lives so that we don't fall into compromise. Can we do that? And we'll end on that. Hallelujah. 1 Peter, the second chapter. Man, this is a verse of if you've been in church for any given time, you probably heard this verse 100 times. 1 Peter, the second chapter. Beginning in verse number 9. I love it. I love this verse. You are a chosen generation. Hallelujah. Look to your neighbor and say, I'm chosen. Chosen. Hallelujah. A royal priesthood. Look to your other neighbor and say, I'm royalty. Amen. Some of you didn't look to your neighbor. Look at this. A holy nation. A holy nation. A couple weeks ago, we talked about the tithe and the blessed life. Sunday morning series. The tithe is holy to God. Do you guys remember? Does anybody remember what the word holy meant then? Anybody? I heard some of them. Anybody remember? Set apart. Do you know what holy means right here? Set apart. That wasn't a trick question. It was real easy. We're a holy nation. Set apart. You know what that means? We're not on the edge. Think about that for a moment. Set apart. A line has been drawn in the sand through Jesus Christ and his teachings. There's no gray area. And so we don't live on the edge of the line. We're set apart, which means if the line is there, I'm going to live my life as far away from that line as I possibly can. If the edge is here, then I'm going to live my life as far away from that edge as I possibly can. Why? Because the Bible says that I'm a holy nation, which means that I'm set apart for God, which means that I don't live, I don't act, I don't reflect. My life doesn't look like the rest of the world. The world might say that I'm a bigot. The world might say that I'm closed-minded. The world might say all that they want to say, but I say this, I am holy, set apart from everything else. Called, chosen by God, royalty in the eyes of God. We've got to understand, church, that we're holy, which means that we are set apart, which means that we should not look like the world around us, but be set apart from the world. All right, that was a soapbox. That was just a free nugget. His own special people, that you might proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light, who once were not a people, but are now the people of God, who had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy. Oh, my goodness. Praise God. Hallelujah. But look what verse number 11 says. Beloved, I beg you, as sojourners and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lusts, which war against the soul, having your conduct honorable among the Gentiles, that when they speak against you as evildoers, that they may, by your good works, which they observe, glorify God in the day of visitation. Three obvious and simple things right here. Three obvious and simple things out of these scriptures that Peter shares with us, his church. Let's read them again. Verse number 11. Beloved, I beg you as sojourners, as pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lusts. Abstain. How do we not get caught up into compromise? To abstain from it. You know what abstain means? Let me say it like this. Remember in the 90s, there was that campaign. I remember I was in high school. It was a really clever campaign. It might have even started in the 80s. But it was a rally against drugs. You anybody remember that? The 90s slogan? Anybody remember that? What was it? Just say no. Right? Somebody offers you drugs. Just say no. Why reinvent the wheel? That was a good slogan. We all remember it. When the temptation comes your way, just say no. When the invitation comes your way, hey man, we're going out drinking tonight. You know that that's not how you ought to be. That's the edge. I got to get away from the edge. Guess what? Just say no. When everybody around you at work, they come around and they huddle around your chair and they start gossiping. Oh my goodness. Did you hear about what happened this weekend? Just say no. It's that easy. You know why it's that easy? Who's in control of your life? Hello? Who drives your car? You or your car? We're not there yet. You drive your life. You are the master of your own destiny. All you have to do is make the decision. Just say no. I remember as a young man dealing with young man issues, I talked to my dad, Daddy, I got a problem with young man issues. You know what I'm talking about? Men, girls, you don't need to worry about that. My dad was expecting this most godly, amazing, just lightning down from heaven. He says, just stop. I'm like, Dad, that's the worst advice I've ever heard in my life. No, it's not. Because you're in control. All you have to do is learn to just say no. When the temptation comes, guys, when the thought comes, hey, man, that girl, huh? Just say no. Just say no to your neck. Don't turn. When those thoughts, when you want to say that word that you've been using, man, I need to stop saying that word around everybody. Just say no. You got control of your mouth. You can close it. Don't reinvent the wheel. I love it. You know, have you ever lied? Has anybody ever? If you don't raise your hand, the Bible tells us where liars go, all right? Have you ever lied and then had to keep lying to keep up the appearances of that lie? It's like the worst thing. You look back and you say, God, would it have just been so much better if I told the truth? I remember one time when I was just a kid in high school. I know some of you are like, Pastor Luke, you're still a kid. I get it. My dad had been riding on me to get an oil change. You get an oil change? Yeah, I got an oil change. You did? Yeah, I got an oil change today. Dad, I did it myself. Really? How many quarts did you put in?
Oh. Two?
Two quarts? Are you kidding me?
So go out there.
What about this? And he's asking me all the questions. It's like one lie after the next. I'm like thinking in my head, okay, I got to remember every step of this intricate web I am weaving. When it comes down to it, it's so much easier just to remember. Mark Twain said it like this. If you tell the truth, you don't have to remember anything. Oh, man. Well, okay, what did I tell that person I did for a living? Just say no. Just say no. It's that simple. I know. I know it's not that simple. The Bible tells us in the book of Thessalonians. We'll put it up on the overhead. What is it? Can you jump there to me? I know we're going to jump around. 1 Thessalonians. It says, abstain from every form of evil. That easy. Don't do it. Just say no. All right, moving on. Look at this one. Verse number 12 in the first part. I know. Sorry, video guys. They're freaking out back there. Pastor Luke, you're jumping around. Having your conduct honorable among the Gentiles. How do we get over this? Honorable conduct. Honorable conduct. How does honorable conduct have anything to do about compromise? How does the world see you? Do they know you're a Christian? Can I get a little in your face? Do they know you're a Christian? If they're coming, hey man, we're partying tonight, man. We got to call because we know you're down. That's not honorable conduct. That's called compromise problems. Honorable conduct. I remember a family member of mine, he's like my camping buddy. He went camping with a bunch of my friends. I was so offended. They went camping up in the local mountains without me. Are you kidding me? On the river that I always go fishing on. I'm like, man. And then they asked, what's up, dude? Oh, man, you know what? It was one of those things. I knew everybody was going to be drinking. I knew that they were going to be up all night cussing. And I knew you'd say no. All of a sudden, my offense, I was like, yeah, right on. I didn't even have to deal with compromise. Why? Because my honorable conduct became a safeguard that the people around me said, no, I don't need to call so-and-so over here. I don't need to ask them over here because I know they're just going to say no. Why? Because my honorable conduct, my reflection of my Christianity says to the world, don't invite them anymore. Don't entice them anymore. Don't get in their face anymore. Why? Because they're going to say no. Honorable conduct. Does the church, does the world know you're a Christian? Oh, girls, I've been talking to the guys. Girls, there should not have been small group meetings at the theater for 50 Shades of Grey. But you all wanted to post about it and you want to friend Pastor Luke on Facebook so that I can see into your intimate business of life. But let me tell you something. If you're out doing movies like that, hanging out with people like that, I'll tell you something right now. You are not living a life of honorable conduct that reflects the glory of God. If I offended you, sorry. But next time a legalized porn movie comes to the theater, your buddy's going to be calling you up. Why? Because you already fell into it. Let's just be real. Can we be real? I mean, come on. Honorable conduct. To reflect the glory of God. God forgive us for using the term grace as a guise. To do whatever we want without consequence. Because I'll tell you something. Every decision, every action that we make in life, we will be held accountable for.
I'll just tell you like it is. Pastor Luke, you offended me.
Grace does not give us the freedom to compromise and not be held accountable. It empowers us to change when we otherwise would not have been able to. I'll read that again. I wrote that. That was me. You can quote me on that one. Grace does not give us the freedom to compromise and to not be held accountable. Grace empowers us to change when we otherwise would not have been able to. Very good. But Pastor Luke, I'm under grace. Paul says all things are lawful, but he also says not all things are profitable. In that same conversation, he says, man, if me eating something's not gonna, is gonna make somebody stumble, then guess what? I won't do it. Honorable conduct. How you present yourself definitely has a way to play in the compromises and the decisions that will come into your life. Honorable conduct. I love this one. The last one he says in 2 Peter. 1 Peter, he says, that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may by your good works, which they observe, glorify God in the day of visitation. How do we deal with compromise? How do you overcome compromise? Your good works. Your good works. Listen, there have been times when I've made some humdinger mistakes. You've been there too? You've made some worse ones than me. Don't be judging me. I'll look back. Hindsight's 20/20. I didn't read my Bible that day. Or for 2 days. Confessions of a pastor tonight, right? Or for 3 days. Oh my goodness, Pastor Luke didn't read his Bible. And guess what? The consequences came. You ever heard the hindsight's 20/20? You look back on something you've done, a stupid decision you've made. Say, man, I was just at the wrong place at the wrong time. I was hungry. I was tired. I was upset. They hurt my feelings, and so I did that. Whatever it might be, good works is an answer. It's a defense mechanism against compromise. Why? Because if you're wrapped up doing the things that you should be doing, guess what? You won't get caught up doing the things you shouldn't be doing. I should not have been a beached whale on the couch all day. I wouldn't have ate a whole bag of chips. I got a friend of mine who's on a diet, just bent on losing weight. Man, they do great. They're eating veggies and they're cooking and they're eating fish instead of red meat and eating salads. And then on the way home from work, he passes a pizza joint. Remember, number one, just say no. What does he do? He hangs out next to the pizza joint. Next thing you know, he comes, man, dude, I messed up today. All right, what? I ate 2 whole pizzas. If you would have just gone home, instead of stopped and drove around in the parking lot, thinking about should I get a pizza or not, you wouldn't have ate the pizza. It's the same exact thing. Jesus said it like this. Jesus says that my food is to do the work or the will of the Father. He says that's what I exist for. The food is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work. But he doesn't leave it. That's not just Jesus' message. Verse number 35. I'll just read along. Verse number 35, he says, do you not say that there's still 4 months and then comes the harvest? Behold, I say to you, lift up your eyes and look at the fields. They're already white for harvest. He who reaps receives wages and gathers fruit for eternal life, that both he who sows and he who reaps may rejoice together. For the saying is true, one sows and another reaps. I sent you to reap for that which you have not labored. Others have labored and you have entered into their labors. Jesus says, my food is to do the will of him who sent them. And he says, I am now sending you to reap a harvest that you didn't sow. You're sowing and somebody else will reap your harvest. If you're busy doing the things that God has you to do, you won't get wrapped up doing the things you're not supposed to do. It's very simple basics of time management. Very good. So when you find yourself hungry, alone, angry, hurt, get wrapped up in doing something for God. One of the best ways to control your flesh, get in there and read the Bible. Get in there and start praying. Working out your salvation, the Bible says. Man, I feel like this. I don't feel like reading the Bible. Well, that's the best time to read the Bible. Amen? That your good works would bring glory to God. You see, you were created. I was created on this earth to glorify God. And when we do what we were created for, we won't get wrapped up in the things that we were not created for. Compromise. It's birthed in selfishness. Me, mine. Compromise, it only sees the here and now. It doesn't look at the long-term effects of what's going on. Compromise, it starts small, but it brings great ruin. But there's ways that you and I can get beyond that to first recognize and realize that if that's the edge of our lives, if that's what the Word of God says, that I don't want to live on the edge because I'm holy, which means I'm set apart, which means I'm going to go the opposite direction. You notice how Abraham said, you go left, I'll go right? How do we get over compromise? How do we deal with it? How do we not stumble and abstain? Go back to the 90s, just say no. Is that easy? How do you overcome compromise by your honorable conduct? When the world knows, man, I'll tell you, it's amazing. Standing up on this pulpit, I gotta live in honorable conduct. I was at the back door on Saturday. You might even be here tonight. I was at the back door on Saturday. A guy comes up to me and says, hey, is there another Luke at this church? No? All right. I'm making your tooth right now, man. I'm getting a crown next week. Like, for real? You're seriously making my tooth right now? Like, no matter where I go, I'm at State Street, walking on Market Night. Pastor Luke! Honorable conduct. If nobody's watching you, remember, God still is. Man. Grace is not a guise for us to do whatever we want without living in consequence. By your good works, do what God designed you to do. Get into the Word of God. Pray, praise. Get out there. Call somebody in your moment of need and just tell them what God's done in your life. I don't know what God's done in my life. Remember what, just read back, go back and read 1 Peter chapter 2. You were once in darkness, but now you're not. That's what God's done. Remember those things. It's so easy for us to get beyond. Ultimately, we have one life. The decisions that we make, we live in action because of those decisions. So it's so important for us to take it seriously, to not lax up on this. You know, the whole theme of the book of 1 Peter is that you and I might endure the hardships of life looking forward to the greater reward as our compensation. It's an encouragement. Church, life is rough, life is hard, but you can do it. And that's why at the very end of the book of 1 Peter in the 5th chapter, you know what he says? Be sober, be vigilant. Why? Because the devil wants to kill you. And he'll bring compromise all day long to your doorstep. And it'll look like small and insignificant decisions, but they'll start out small, but they'll end in great ruin. That's why it's so important for us to be sober, to be vigilant, to not let up, to not back off. That's why I said in the very beginning, you're not too far into God that you can't succumb to compromise in your life. But if we abstain, if we let our good conduct be known, understanding that God watches us and that we live in grace, not so that we can do whatever we want, so that we can be who God wants us to be. So that we can do godly things, good work. My food is to do the work of him who sent me. That's our food too. I'll leave you with this little bit of tidbit, this little bit of wisdom, because everybody always asks, when's Pastor Jim going to preach again? So I'll leave you with the words of my dad. Taught me all my life. He said this, he said, son, what you compromise to keep, you'll lose. What you compromise to keep, you'll lose. Jesus said it like this. What good is it for a man to gain the whole world and lose his soul? Oh, but Pastor Luke, I don't want to be that kind of person. I still want my friends to invite me. I want to know what everything's going on. There's actually a physical condition of the fear of missing out because of social media. Man, everybody's having fun. They went to Disneyland without me. Whatever it is. What you compromise to keep, you'll lose. If you lower your standards so that you can be in with the people that you used to be in with, you'll lose it. So true. Church, we're holy. We're set apart. Let's not fall into the trap. And please, please, it's getting old. Let's stop using the word grace as a guise for us to do whatever the heck we want, because that is so far from what Jesus has taught us. But grace has enabled us, empowered us, and equipped us to become who he has called us to be, so that we can live what the Bible says we are, new creations, dead, crucified, no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. That's the word of God for us. Did you guys get something out of the word of God today? Amen. Hey, listen, before we go any further today, today's a special day. There's a member of the house today that is celebrating a big day. My buddy over here on the keyboard looking down, shaking his head because he's like, don't do it. This guy right over here, Elijah. Do you guys appreciate Elijah and our worship team? Elijah is officially 30 years old today. It's the big 3-0. Elijah, happy birthday, man. We love you. We appreciate you and all that you do and leading us every week and every service in the presence of God with music. You're so gifted. There's nothing you can't do, my friend. Happy 30th birthday. If you see Elijah afterwards, or just holler at him or hoot at him and tell him happy birthday. Give him a shout out on Facebook or something like that. And we do appreciate that. It's great to have that. He's a good guy. Hey, man, when you turn 30, your hair starts falling out. Oh, okay. All right. All right, before we go any further today, I know we've laughed. I've tried to keep it as lighthearted as I can, but hey, listen, some very important things I want to do today. Before we leave, it would be an atrocity, it'd be horrible for us to leave under the assumption that everybody in this room is all right with God. When the reality is that there are those of you in this place today that if you were to die, despite what you think or despite how you feel, despite what you might believe, you would find yourself in the wrong position with God. You see, the fact of the matter is that life is a fragile thing. We're all one virus, we're all one accident, we're all one epidemic or incident away from our eternal existence. Whether you believe it or not, you're given two opportunities, two places to go upon your physical death where you'll spend eternity, heaven or hell. I don't know about that, Pastor Luke. I haven't seen that, or I haven't heard about that. I heard about that one guy that wrote a book and said, and then he said it wasn't real. Just because you don't think it's real, because you haven't felt it or experienced it in your own life, doesn't mean it's not. It's like saying burying your head in the sand isn't going to make it go away. Heaven's a real place. Hell's a real place. Real enough for Jesus to teach about it. Real enough for God to tell us about it in the Word of God. Real enough for the Bible to be preserved over thousands of years. Why? So that you and I would take it serious today. That upon our death here physically, the Bible tells us that our life's a vapor in the grasp of eternity. And upon our death here, we'll either live in heaven in eternity with God in paradise, or we'll live in hell. The decision's yours. So I want you to ask this question to yourself. Examine your heart, the Bible says, a man ought to examine himself. If you were to die, come to grasps with the reality of your mortality. A young guy once told me, Pastor Luke, people who are young can't even comprehend the reality that they might die. Listen, every single person on the face of this earth has the same destiny when it comes to their physical existence, death, with the exception of those who are brought up to heaven by Jesus Christ. You're going to die. The Bible says it's appointed once for a man to die and face judgment. If you were to die today, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? Boom. Just think about it right now. Where would you be? Not tomorrow. Not the next day, right now. You don't know what tomorrow holds. You know, if you say, well, I think, I hope, I wish, man, I've got the most positive outlook, I really desire, I want to go to heaven. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that you can get yourself into heaven because you want to, because you hope so? I hear that a lot, Pastor Luke. I hope I'll go to heaven. Man, there's so much more than just hoping. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because your parents told you as a child growing up that you were a Christian? Nowhere in the Word of God does it say that because you attend church because you heard the pastor preach. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you've given yourself the title. Man, we Americans, we love to give ourselves titles nowadays. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you've given yourself the title, because you were told, or because you thought all along that you were a Christian, that means that you're going to get to heaven? It doesn't work by a system of classifications. Well, I'm not a Hindu or a Buddhist or a Muslim. I always thought that that meant by default that I was a Christian. It doesn't work that way. You won't find that in the Word of God. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you're a good person, that because you do good things, you never rob the 7-Eleven, you don't drive too fast on the freeway, you try to help out your fellow human being. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that good people go to heaven? You can't make it to heaven because you're a good person, because you do good things. As a matter of fact, the Bible tells us that our good deeds according to God's righteousness are like filthy rags. You see, nothing you and I could ever do on our own would ever make us good enough. It's not about how many times you sit in church, about whether you attended Sabbath school or catechism classes. It's not about whether or not somebody sprinkled water over you when you were a baby and called you baptized. The Bible doesn't speak about that. The only way we can get to God's heaven is God's way. Unfortunately for you and I, that way is perfection. And we've all fallen short. Remember when I asked that question, has anybody lied? There it was. We've all fallen short. We've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. The only way we can get to God's heaven is God's way, and Jesus Christ is that way. Can't do it your way, can't do it my way, can't earn it, you can't buy it, you can't work for it, you can't sit in church long enough to deserve it. The only thing you and I can do is accept it. See, the Bible tells us that the gift of God is eternal salvation through Jesus Christ. It's a gift. And like any gift, it's a choice, a decision that you make whether or not you're going to accept it or you're going to reject it or pass it by. That's it. God's given you a free will choice. He's not a manipulator. He's not going to connive his way or force his way. He's not going to kick down the door of your life and make you. He's done everything he could to ensure you have the option by giving for you and for me, Jesus Christ, to die on a cross for our sins, feet and bloody mess. Jesus, his own words, he says it this way. He is the way, the truth, and the life. No one goes to the Father except through him. So today, let's not do this any other way but God's way, through Jesus Christ. Jesus, in John the 3rd chapter, he's speaking to a religious man, Nicodemus, a man who gave to the poor, a man who did all the right things, said all the right things, memorized scripture. Jesus says these words to Nicodemus. In order to inherit the kingdom of God, you must be born again. What does it mean to be born again? Well, I'll tell you, it's not what Hollywood, it's not what movies or the internet's made it out to be. You think of weirdo, crazy, out of control Christianity, but be born again from the beginning of God's word to the end of God's word has always meant the same thing in the heart and the eyes of God. Here it is. It means that you've given God all of your heart, you've given God all of your life. It's an all or nothing relationship with God through his son, Jesus Christ. Let me prove it to you. In the book of Revelation, Jesus is speaking. It's his final plea to the church. He says, man, you think you've got it all together. You think you're wealthy, you think you're rich, but you don't realize how naked and destitute you are. He says, oh, I wish that you would come to me. It's his final plea to the church, and he says, I'm coming back, and when I come back, I'd rather find that you're hot, or I'd rather find that you're cold, because he goes on and he says, because if I find that you're lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. What does lukewarm mean? Think of it like this. It means that you've got your ups and your downs and your ins and your outs in your relationship, in your walk with God. You're not wholehearted for God. You're not wholehearted against God. Listen, you've given into too many compromises. You've got some of God in you, but you've got a lot of compromise in you as well. Maybe today, as I was speaking, as the message touched your heart, and he says, man, that was an ouch message for me. Maybe it's time for you to examine the reality of where you stand with God. And listen, I love you enough, I'll tell you the truth. Whether you like me or not, I'll still tell you the truth. That you can't make it into heaven because you want to. You can't make it into heaven because you hope so. You can't make it into heaven because you sit in church or because you drop money in a bucket. The only way you can make it into heaven is to accept the gift of Jesus Christ and the salvation, the price that was paid for you and I. The Bible says that we are saved by grace through faith. Today I want to offer to you that opportunity. Jesus says these words. He says that if you confess him before men, he will confess you before his Father. But if you deny him, he says he will deny you. The decision's yours. Your free will choice today. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to count to three in just a moment. I'll go one, two, and then on the count of three, I'll go three. And I'll smack my hands together real loud, just like that. And I'm going to ask you to do something. I'm going to invite you, entice you to do something real bold. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to ask you to pop your hand up. You see, what you're doing by raising your hand is you're making a decision. It's not a feeling. It's a decision. You're saying, you know what? I want to give my heart. I want to give my life to Jesus Christ. I want to make sure today that I get into heaven. Pastor Luke, what you were talking about, you were talking to me. You see, I'm a man. I'll see your hand. I'll acknowledge it. And you can put it right back down. Oh, if I raise my hand, I might be embarrassed. I'm not going to embarrass you. But even if you were embarrassed, wouldn't it be better to spend a moment of embarrassment than an eternity in hell? Because you couldn't go forward for God in a warm and welcome and loving place? It starts by making the decision today. Listen, you've had doctors, dentists, you've even made DMV appointments. Today, it's a divine appointment between you and God. The Bible says it's the goodness of God that draws men to repentance. It's not me. It's not the person next to you. It's God speaking to you right now. Called, chosen, a royal priesthood like we talked about. Set apart. God's saying, that's my desire for you. And it starts by accepting the invitation and making the decision. Who should raise your hands? If you've never given your heart, you've never given your life to Jesus, that's you in just a moment. Get ready, pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. You can put it right back down. Who should raise your hands? If you're not sure, maybe you did this as a child or in the youth group, you went to a Harvest Crusader, you prayed that prayer once long ago on TV, but you've never really followed through. If that's you, just a moment. Get ready, pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. You can put it right back down. Who should raise your hands? Maybe you've been doing your own thing instead of God's thing, been living lukewarm, been running from God instead of to God. Hey, come on. Let's quit playing games. Stop messing around. Make this the day you go forward in your relationship with God, ensuring your place with Jesus in heaven, in paradise for eternity. The decision is yours and yours alone to make. And I think you're pretty smart. So I'm going to count to three. If that's you all across this auditorium, whether you're in the front row, back row, side to side, left to right, in the family rooms, out in the foyer, watching on the television, around the campus, hear the sound of my voice, or even at home. If you're still with us on the live stream, hey, if that's you, get ready. In just a moment, you can minimize the screen. There's a blue button you can push called Know God. You need to push that button. The decision is yours today, if that's you in this place, to get ready to make that decision, make that proclamation. I'm going to count to three wherever you're at. If that's you, get ready. Pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. You can put it right back down. You ready? Here we go today. One, two, three. Let me see your hands in this place today. Say, I got to give my heart. I want to give my life to Jesus. One, two, three. Three wise people. Anybody else in this place today? Three people in the house today. Where are you at? You say, man, I wonder if I should. You should. Come on. I can feel you in this place. I know there's more than three. Say, man, I wonder if I should. I wonder if this guy's ever going to shut up. If you're thinking that, hey, guess what? You probably need to make some decisions in your life. Three wise people in this place. Anybody else in this place? I didn't embarrass them. I won't embarrass you. I'm not satisfied with that. I can feel you in this place. I know you. I know that you're here. I know that you've got the butterflies. Man, should I? I just don't know if I can. You're at a pivotal point in your life. You'll always be at the pivotal point until you make the decision to make a change. And today is that day. Wherever you're at, you say, man, I need to give my heart. I need to give my life to Jesus Christ. Pop your hand up. Number four, number five, where are you at in this place? All right, I'm not going to make take you. You've been told. You've heard it. Your choice, your call. Here's what we're going to do for the three of you guys that raise your hands. Praise God. Hallelujah. Let's give the Lord a great big praise. You don't get saved by raising your hand. You're making a decision. With every decision comes action. Now it's time to act on that. We're going to do that together. We don't want you to go through this alone. So here's what we're going to do. We're all going to stand. If you raise your hand, or maybe, you know what, maybe you're number four, maybe you're number five, and the Spirit of God's speaking to you right now, and you can't get it off of you. If that's you, in just a moment, when we all stand, I want you to grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, your Bible, a friend if you need a friend. I want you to grab your family. Grab a friend with you. Or look to somebody that raised their hand and say, you know what, come on, come on, I'll go with you. I want you to get out of your chair, get into the aisle, and come meet me up here at this altar. We're going to change destinies together right here, right now. Let's follow through with that action. Let's all stand. If you raise your hand, or maybe you should have, come on. If that's you in this place, get out of your seat, get out of your chair. Come meet me up here, right now. Let's do this together.
Lord, I give you my heart. I give you my soul. And I'll live for you alone. Every breath that I take, and every moment I'm awake, Lord, have your way with me.
You guys came from over there. There were hands in this section. I don't know where you're at, but I love you enough to tell you the truth. I've been telling you the truth all night. You don't get saved by raising your hands. I'm looking at this section because I saw three hands in this section. I want to tell you the truth. You don't get saved because you raised your hand and went through a ceremony in church. You get saved because you give your heart and life to Jesus Christ, and we're going to do that together. So I'm going to ask Elijah to sing that song one more time. And if you raised your hands, come on. Don't start the first few moments out with your walk with God in disobedience. Follow through with what you're doing today. Make that decision, and your life will never be the same. It's your choice. Elijah, go for it, buddy.
Lord, I give you my heart.
Come on.
I give you my soul. And I'll live for you alone. Every breath that I take, and every moment I'm away. Lord, have your way.
You're so important. The Spirit of God is holding up the whole service for you. Are you going to respond? We're here for you. Praise God. Are you both coming or is one? Hey, it's all right. This is a moment to be proud of. And you know why, guys? Here's the deal. For one, you need to know that God loves you so much. He made me look like an idiot for you. All right? That's pretty cool. You're not going to a funeral. You're not going to the morgue. All right? You're going to a birthday celebration. Today's the first day of the rest of your life. You know what that means? That's a reason to celebrate. That's a reason to be happy. Make it a great decision. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy right over here? His name's Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel's a really cool guy. He's going to do a couple things. He's going to take you guys just right over there. Nothing weird goes on. I am as weird as it gets. There's a nail right there on that. That's as weird as it gets, all right? They only bring out the snakes when Pastor Dan preaches, okay? So we're totally cool. Just kidding. Totally messing. He's going to take you guys right over there. He's going to lead you in a prayer. You get saved by asking Jesus, inviting him to be the Lord and Savior of your life. Okay, so he's going to lead you in a prayer. Second thing he's going to do is he's going to give you some free information. Real easy reading. You say, man, I got saved. I raised my hand. Now what do I do? We're going to help point you in the right direction. Third thing he's going to do is he's going to invite you to come back. Hang out with us. We want you to hang out with us. We want to get you connected with a friend here at church. Somebody that will meet with you, teach you some things about the Word of God for a couple of weeks. You're not joining some big, long program. Just meeting with a friend for a couple of weeks to teach you some things about the Word of God, to get you strong so that you don't go back to the life that you're walking away from, but you go forward in everything that God has for you. So if you guys would just turn to your left, my right, go right over there with Pastor Joel, all right? Praise God. Hallelujah.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer, of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.